Thank you. As Aaron said, my name's Stephen Bryant. Just a little bit about myself. I am an award-winning cover artist. I'm also an art director. I graphic design as well, but most people know me as just a cover artist. I graduated from the Academy in 2009, so it's been about 5 years. And it's kind of incredible, once you get out there, how much things change. Cover art is super demanding because, as you guys know now, everybody wants a photograph, right? Everyone wants to take a picture of Robert De Niro, throw a red highlight on it, and there you go. You got your cover. You mean, if you've seen the cover for The Family, for the movie poster, it's literally all them in black and white and then red background. That's it. So the biggest thing I try and give to people is I give them that realistic quality, but I make it better. Well, at least I think I make it better. So, I mean, I'm sure you guys have walked around and seen the Breaking Bad picture, and I've had people like, oh man, that's a good photo. I always tell people, no, Doug, like, I do everything hand-drawn. Everything start from finish is digital, but I do it with my hands. So I'm just gonna talk a little bit today about where I was when I left the Academy. And this is important because when you leave, a lot of people are like chickens with their head cut off. They don't know where to go, they don't know what to do. They think if they have a portfolio and a postcard and they wear a suit, they're gonna get jobs. That doesn't really happen anymore. That happened more in the 50s where you can mail a postcard out and you get a phone call. Now people are a little more discreet. So click that button. Once I left the Academy, I basically did everything in gouache and oil painting. Particularly, this is all gouache. And when I left, there was a business communications class, 101 kind of deal. And in order to get extra credit, or like an A++, you had to go interview someone who was an alumna. And I was like, okay, you know, I'm pretty personable, I could give it a shot. And I contacted like Alex Ross. I'm like, hey, he didn't respond. So that's fine. I had worked with someone else in the past. I had done a couple presentations right here with Doug Kalaba when he came to visit. And then Doug also had a Blackhawks painting he did. And it was at Blackhawks, and I went there when they had the Academy to help out. So I'm like, okay, I met Doug a couple times. I'll shoot him an email, see if he's interested. Well, Doug emails me right back. He's like, yeah, sure. Come on over. We'll set you up. We'll talk about your portfolio. And I did, and I was sweating the whole time. I was so incredibly nervous. I'm like, you know, what do you think of my advertising project? And he's, you know, it's good. It's fine. Let's talk about something else. So, long story short, Doug really liked my stuff. We kind of hit it off. We've been friends ever since. But then I go back to school, I turn in my stuff, and a couple of the students are like, you know, your stuff kind of lends to comic books. And at that time, I had never done anything comic related. It was strictly for newspapers and advertising. That's what I thought I was gonna do. So you may come in here and think, I'm gonna be an anime artist. And then when you leave, there's something completely different. You just never know what is gonna happen. But everyone's like, yeah, you should try comics. You could do comic covers. I'm like, okay, I could give it a shot. So I ended up doing a Watchmen piece, which for some reason isn't displaying, but that's okay. And I took it to a convention, and Doug is there. And Doug comes over and he's like, hey, have you met Joe Gentile? I'm like, I don't know anyone. And he takes me over. Joe's like, yeah, let me introduce you. Well, Joe just happens to be the art director at Moonstone Publishing for comics. And I'm like, hi, Joe. And he looks over my stuff, and he's like, oh, I really like your style. We're relaunching Domino League. And I'm like, okay, I don't know what Domino League is, but I could do it. And he sends me some stuff, and he's like, here, paint this. I'm like, okay, I paint it, and, you know, Joe loved the cover, the author Nancy Holder loved the cover, and I personally love the cover. I still have this frame on my wall. One thing I'm really big on my covers, I don't over-sexualize women. I just don't. They wanted, you know, this very standard, larger-than-life breast, leaned over kind of deal, and I'm like, you know what? What if I made her tough? What if I made her badass, opposed to a sex object? And Nancy Holder actually ended up finding me at one of these shows later. She's like, this is amazing. This is what I always thought the character should look like. You know, she's tough, but still, you know, sexy. And this went over extremely well. I ended up getting a lot more cover work from this. This is my square. Okay. So then people started contacting me for book covers. And this was the first sci-fi cover I did. As you can tell, once you leave the Academy, you start to feel a little more comfortable with what you're doing. You're doing it every single day for, you know, 10 hours at a time after your part-time job. and this was for Walking Shadow. It was from Clifford Royal Johns. Super nice guy, his first cover he ever did. And he told me, he's like, hey, I want something from Chicago, kind of like meets Blade Runner. I'm like, okay, I could do that. And so I painted this, and this ended up, you know, kind of winning a couple awards, best of Grand Mal Press, all that kind of stuff. It was really cool. I finally started to get some recognition for what I was doing. And the reason I picked this one in particular, I don't know if how many of you are illustration majors or had that class with Tom. You don't have to put your hand up, that's okay. We have to put it one more time. Thank you. No, but so I ended up doing this, and Tom always used to tell me, you know, if you don't really like the subject matter, or you know, you just don't really want to paint this, find something on there that you love and make it the best you can. And I don't really know sci-fi that well. So I'm like, okay, I'm gonna really focus on that one-way sign. I think that one-way sign is fantastic. And I always tell people, like, look at that one-way sign. Like, the tape on it. I even told Tom before I came in here, I'm like, I'm gonna talk about that one-way sign. And, you know, this was my, I'd say, transcendence into, he could do more than comics. He could still do stark colors and, you know, his whites and blacks, but he could kind of do more. So from there, I started actually getting more. Oh, there's the last one, it's out of order. That's the one I was telling you guys about. This is the piece I had at the con. I actually painted this in school, framed it, and took it. And on the right was my mock-up for my portfolio. So that actually didn't get printed. Okay. So then from there, Rock and Roll Comics contacted me. And they were talking about, hey, we're bringing back Rock and Roll Comics in general, the whole line. They were doing a Led Zeppelin, they were doing a Beatles, they were doing Pink Floyd. And they were asking me if I was interested in Pink Floyd. I'm like, my favorite band, so let's do it. I'm actually wearing a Pink Floyd shirt under all this right now. And I took everything I could muster to get this done, because this actually had to be done in 2 days. They called me on Wednesday, it was due Friday. So I'm like, oh, okay, you know, and this is still all done with gouache. And I don't know how many people use gouache, but it takes time. You know, I gotta lay everything out, I gotta draw it, I gotta paint it. And unlike most people, I paint everything black and white first in gouache. And then I could color over it and airbrush. And this ended up being huge. Like, I won some awards for this. I was on MTV.com. They gave me an award for, like, best traditional artist. I'm like, I don't know how valuable it is for MTV to give me an art award. I'm like, that's cool. And like, I got to meet the bands. They all signed it. And it was just amazing. Like, things were actually starting to click. And I was starting to get some momentum. The problem is that I'm partially colorblind. I have a really hard time with blues and greens. And no one actually knew this. I think Tom may remember it, but I didn't really talk about it in school. I didn't want to use it as a crutch. I didn't want people to, you know, oh, you tried. Like, no, I judge me how you would if I went out there. Because when I go out there, no one's going to say, oh, he's got a disability. Let's pay him anyway. They just won't use my stuff. But I was really, really stressed, and I was working overtime. And when you're stressed, your eyesight starts to go. So my eyesight started to go. And I kind of took a step back. I kind of realized, like, okay, maybe spending like 50 hours trying to get this to look just the way I want and then guessing at what colors what isn't the best method. So I stepped back, I started doing graphic design, and I taught myself how to paint digitally. Because the bonus of painting digitally, and I know other people would argue this, but the bonus for me, so I can have a palette in the top right of my corner, and it says, you know, evergreen green, or dark blue, or midnight blue, and I know exactly what the color is. So there's no guessing, opposed to before, I put a color down, and if it's green, I hope so. I have no idea. I'd have my wife check my colors sometimes. So I ended up taking a year off, learned Corel Painter. I know most people don't use Corel, but I like Corel. And then I came back, and I started doing digital stuff. The problem with this is people started to think they're photos. And I could see that, because I spent a year learning all the tricks and everything there is, and I wanted to show this just because it's straight up a wall with blood on it. But I started to learn these tricks of, like, oh, texture and scratches and things like that. I'm like, yeah, I could do this, because with gouache, you're out of time limit. You may have to go back, and you have to pick stuff up with a napkin and wipe it off. With this, I'm like, I'll come back in an hour and I'll add some highlights here. I don't like those highlights, I'll take it off on that layer. So I actually started to go too far. I started to take things to a photo level. And the other reason I want to show this, because this guy is going to pop up a lot. He's one of the most prolific authors in London. I'm his exclusionary cover artist. So, but yeah, so I started transitioning in Corel. Here's another one of his. And this one is called Savage, same guy. As you can tell, still going super realistic, but everything is done digitally and hand-drawn. And let's see if I get out here real quick. The problem was, this actually started to bite me in the butt. I would win awards for covers, but then unless people knew my previous work, they would stop hiring me. They're like, I could get a photo off Shutterstock or Dreamstime or any other the 9 million ones and just put it up there and put some type on it. So I had to take another step back. I'm like, I have to rebrand myself a little bit. I have to show everyone that these aren't, in fact, photos through hand painted. So I just recorded it. I don't know if this is gonna blast music, but. Oh, it does. So I just recorded myself doing everything. And it may not seem like that big of a deal. These videos made people want to hire me. It's just about how you brand yourself. Because if you're ultra realistic, like I said, people think it's a photograph. But if I show this to anyone, they're like, oh, he can do my painting. He can take what I want and draw it out and then render it any way I want. So all of a sudden, I'm a hot deal. And I'm gonna be quiet for a second. just that easy. Did you mark the applause break? So yeah, I started doing stuff like that, and people started contacting me. And I'm not just talking independent authors, I'm talking, you know, toy companies, which was awesome, because I love toys. They would contact me for, let me just get this back open. They contacted me for toy box art, which I thought was amazing, because I never even thought that was a possibility in school. I thought at that time, you know, that's just not gonna happen. I guess I'll get to that in a second. Let's just play this. Okay, let's try that again. So yeah, but this I wanted to show you guys, because this is something most people don't see. They'll see sketches and they'll see thumbnails, but when I was in the academy, I could, you know, Rich would have a project due that day, and I'll do thumbnails during lunch, and I'll give it to him. And that was okay, because it was college, and that's fine. But when you go out there, and you have a client who wants something very, very specific, and they ask you to do it, and you do like a 10-second sketch, and they're not in the same room with you, and you send it to them, they're mad. They're spending money on you to create something professional. They want it to look like it's supposed to look. So what I started doing is I'd send them these extremely detailed sketches. Now you may say like, oh, this is a waste of time. Well, see, the thing is, when I did this, this actually ended up saving time. Because at the back end, I'm not doing extra revisions. Because they know exactly what they're getting. So I usually send about two. You know, I talk to the client, I ask them, okay, what do you want on the cover? What don't you want on the color? What are some of the colors you want? What's the type you want on the front? And I just kind of set it up for them, and I send this over. And I'd say generally, each of these sketches takes me about 30 minutes or so. And, you know, I send it over, and they're like, I don't like it. I'm like, okay, that's fine. I only spent 30 minutes for it. I don't like that one either. That's fine. Put it on the side. I don't like that one. All right, put it on the side. And then at that point, you just keep working on this one thing instead of working on a painting that's already done. Because that's one thing they don't teach you here, is like revisions after a critique are optional. Revisions at this stage aren't. You have to do it, you don't get paid. You know, that gas bill isn't gonna pay itself. So you just kind of have to work it a little bit. So this is one I did for Ian Rob Wright, and then I think I have another one for Ian as well. And again, I sent him the same kind of deal. He told me kind of what he wanted, and I created the sketches for him. He reviewed it, and this one he actually liked the bottom right there, and as you can see, it's almost identical to the painted piece. The best thing about this is, for me doing it digitally, once they accept that sketch, I can start painting. I don't have to redraw anything. If I do a thumbnail, I have to redraw everything. So I'm actually wasting more time. Instead of doing this, I can get right to work. So if they want something, you know, tomorrow, if I send them that proof, I can start painting. I don't have to spend time and do it, and all of a sudden it's 1 a.m. and I haven't even started painting yet. So it actually allows me more time. It's weird, you may not think of it, but it actually gives me more time to work on the final piece and the text and the colors and everything, opposed to, all right, let me draw this barbed wire again, let me see if he likes it. Because, you know, other thing I don't do skies in sketches. I always tell people, like, it's kind of hard to draw a sky for you to see it. It'll be ominous. Just trust me. This was, I'm sorry, I also forgot to mention, at this point, I was also working at Sailgad Publishing as an art director, which was fantastic. I mean, I got to work with a ton of artists, a ton of authors, and they did not have me on a exclusionary deal, so when I finished the cover for somebody, I could still work with that author outside of the company. So if they wanted to, you know, individually publish something not affiliated with Sailgad, I could still do their cover work. And this is one I did for Bryant Elspa. He basically called me and he says, you know, I want something like Twilight. I don't know what that means. So, you know, I was like, okay. can you send me some examples? And he sends me like the covers. I don't know if you've seen the covers, but they're pretty much black and like one item in red. And I'm like, okay, we could do something like this. What color do you want to focus on? He's like, blue. I'm like, crap, I can't see blue. But I was like, okay, fine. And then he gave me complete freedom. He says, you know, I want it iconic, and I want it stoic, and I want it heartfelt. And the story of this, he sent me over, and this is actually one I read, was about a man who lost a woman who keeps coming to the bridge, like the bridge where she died every single day, and he would go there just to meet her. I'm like, okay, I don't want to do like a bridge or anything. Like that's not heartfelt. I was like, what do they do when they meet? Like, they probably like hold hands. You know, like they're adults, not gonna make out on the beach. And I'm like, you know, let's do that. And I came up with this idea, and Bryant loved it. Like, you know, and this, I'm not sure how, but this has become probably the most popular thing I've ever painted. It's, every time I go on his site, it's there. And, you know, I won a couple of awards for it. I won, like, best romance artist. I'm like, I never considered myself a romance artist. But I'm like, again, you know, you never know what you're going to be doing. And from here, he actually started up sharing it to people. I started to get a lot of covers for this very iconic stuff. We're just going to jump to this. And this is something I actually did this year. So as you can see from that last one, how simple, you grow as you don't even realize it, but you keep growing. This is for Lindsay Brooker. She is one that contacted me through Bryant. And she's like, hey, I'm kind of like a young adventure author. Can you do these? And I'm like, hell yeah, let's do it. You know, I love action adventure kind of stuff. And she's like, I want the girl to be tough. I want her to fight a monster, and I want a character in the back. I'm like, okay, anything in particular? The sword has to glow. Okay. And I came up with this, and again, it was a huge hit. People really dug it. I still dig it. It's on my website. I just love how it came out. I love how the cut, like, she's got like seven light sources going on her. And from this, I started to get a lot of people realizing that I do women well. You know, so I would get, you know, calls for comics, like, hey, I want my woman to look like Hit Girl, not, you know, Power Girl. Like, okay, and I work it out, and I do concept art for that, and, you know, God bless Lindsay, because she is also super prolific, and she would give me a cover, like, every 2 weeks. And that's the big thing you guys may not realize, is if you get a really good author, they will pump out stuff. They'll want covers for short stories. So they'll spend a day on a story, and like, hey, I want an image to go with it. Okay, all of a sudden you're working on that, and oh, my next book's coming out next month, let's work on that. I want to work on my font, let's work on that. And all of a sudden, one client who just really likes your stuff, got 6 or 7 projects going on in 1 month. So, like, even if you think you're an illustrator, work on your type design. Work on the effects, work on how it works. Think of placement. You know, when I did this painting, I already had that font built. So I knew, like, okay, I can't put anything that important at the top or that important at the bottom. My original design had the hand on top of the font. I thought that would look cool. He was kind of holding it, and she didn't like that. So so I just put it in the front. And again, this was super popular, and I dig it. And this is another one I did for her. It was the same series. You know, I kept that same font. So all of a sudden, I'm getting paid for a font I already created. So it's just all about maximizing what you do to make as much money as you possibly can. That sounds bitter, but I'm an illustrator. I'm a work, you know, I'm a gun for hire. I want to make money. I'm not Picasso. I'm not Van Gogh. I need to pay that bill. So, you know, she's wanted this. This was literally done in about 4 or 5 days. I already had the font laid out. She loved it. Bam. Went to print. And this is another series she had been doing. She's like, hey, can you do this? I'm like, absolutely. Let's do that. And again, I did that. I started playing. I like to play with a lot of light. So I started doing, you know, the God rays and everything like that. Build that font. This was about another 3 or 4 day turnaround. Okay. And then I went back to comics. A good buddy of mine, Dan Dougherty, he does Beardo, he does Touching Evil, but he contacted me and he had no money. And he wanted me to, you know, see if I'd be interested in the cover. And, you know, I was, at this point, like I said earlier, I was really just trying to make as much money as I can, get my name out there. Then I started thinking, you know, I don't want to be a gun for hire. I don't want to be a vigilante my whole life, because if you're, you know, once and gone, you could have a client that you see once a year. So I talked to Dan, and I was like, okay, let's strike a deal for rights. And I told him, you know, I'm not going to tell you the full deal, but basically, every print of this that's made, I get a cut. Every time that cover's used on something, I get a cut of what's made from it. So this is something you guys got to think about, too. If you're going to use your art, make sure you keep as much rights to it as you can. Because when I first left here, I'd make a painting, and I'd give it to someone for $40. And then I'd see it on Facebook, and I'd see it here, and it's used for, you know, a cover, and I'm like, well, crap. Like, there's nothing I could do, because it's already out there. Kind of like George Romero in Night of the Living Dead. He didn't do the copyrights on that, and that movie's public domain. Every time you see it on air, he's not making a dime. But Dan asked me to do this, and I did. And I dig how it came out, and I think I have another one here. So the series comes out, I'd say, about every 2 months, and he has me do all the covers for it. And I've been recording the videos and process for this all on my YouTube page. But the cool thing about Touching Evil is it's actually up for rights right now with Netflix for the like their individual original programming. So we're working out the deals for that now. That's another one. It's a kid's book.
Say it.
And this is one I actually finished yesterday. So I thought it would be kind of cool, a little sharing on top. I don't really use a lot of sci-fi, but Carol just really wanted to use me, and she loved that lens flare, and I was like, all right, we'll put it all over the place. But, you know, again, I really wanted to just bring home that, like, I have become known for horror, but besides that, I've become known for really strong women, and I love it. It's awesome. This is also one of the horror ones I did. This one is for Jacob Rain, 2014. He really just wanted a super bloody cover. And the cool thing is this actually just won an award at UK. I do a lot of work overseas, and it's kind of like when you're 11 years old and you tell your friends that, yeah, I have a girlfriend, but, you know, she lives in Canada. And because no one believes me. I'm like, yeah, I have a lot of followers in the UK. And they're like, uh-huh. But yeah, Jacob Rain, this cover here, won a couple of awards. That's UK horror cover of 2014. Oh, these are the toys designs I was telling you guys about. I actually did the first one for the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and then I did one for the Crypt Keeper, and I asked the company, I'm like, hey, is it cool if I just keep doing these for my website? And they're like, yeah, sure. Like, they had no problem with it whatsoever. So I think I got like 80 or something like on my website right now. Because I love these. I love scary movies. I love that kind of stuff. And like I always tell people, it's kind of like a musician warms up before a gig. Like, I usually spend 2-3 hours on these. So before I start painting, I'm like, yeah, let's throw a pumpkin head. All right, cool. And then I'll get into real work. Oh, that's it. Also, Breaking Bad is a good invention. So there you go.
Anybody have any questions for?
All right, let's try this mic again.
Take it down there.
Is it working? Mm-hmm. For the people you draw, do you have models posed for you, or is that just out of your head?
It's actually a combination of both. So, for example, that last one I showed you, the sci-fi one, I had someone pose for the man, and I had someone pose for a woman. But unfortunately, they wanted a last minute revision. And that little revision was, oh, the main character is not African American, she's actually Caucasian. Wow. So I ended up having to pose for that myself. And I do it all the time. I just really need a light source, and then I could work it from there. So it's actually, you know, if I have a month to work on something, I'll hire a model or two. And if I don't, I'll just kind of look in the mirror and take a selfie. I'm like, okay, this is how the lights land. Let's work it.
So you just use yourself for the pose, not like the anatomy? Or?
I use myself for the anatomy, just how it would lie. But like, sometimes I'll use my hand just as is, because, you know, the difference between a man hand and a woman hand is nails and maybe elongated fingers. But that's about it. Some of my early stuff for comics, it's just me. Like that Domino Lady one, if you notice, there are a couple people in the car. Oop. Those are all me. And they didn't even notice. I'm like, cool. So.
Take
That's also me. I'm also down on the game. Anybody else?
Mr. Webb has a question.
Sorry.
Maybe we get a microphone. Hold.
Hey, Stephen. I don't know about anybody else, but I really enjoyed seeing that process video. That was pretty amazing. And could you walk us through some more about just where you start, what your work day is like, what time you get up in the morning, what's the first thing you do?
Sure. I used to get up at 10. Then I had a little girl on around 3. But, I mean, the day is pretty straightforward. I mean, you know, everyone's thanking me for coming, but otherwise I'd just be sitting in front of my computer all day. Or I usually get up around 10, or used to. I'd have breakfast, and then I just start work. Like, that's really it. I'm kind of a workaholic. I would work from 10 to, you know, easily 2 or 3 in the morning. And unfortunately, also a lot of my clients were from the UK, so the time difference kind of got me in the butt, too, because it's 9 a.m. there, and it's 1 a.m. here, so I'm like, okay, I got to be awake for this phone call. And I'd have to pound coffee at 1 a.m. so I understand what they're talking about. And yeah, from there, that's really about it. I try not to work on weekends, you know. I try to keep as much structure as I possibly can. A lot of people get into the habit of working every single day, and that's fine. I draw every single day. You know, I'll draw on my phone, but I don't want to make it where 24 hours a day I'm on call. Because that's, you know, you kind of have to set parameters for yourself, because otherwise, you know, you're working till you're dead, and yeah, you see my art, but you didn't really live your life. And so as for the process, I'll show you guys a different video. I'll try and talk over this one. And I probably should say, these pieces that I'm showing that aren't for book covers, like the Breaking Bad on the poster and that kind of stuff, those are all for conventions. That's probably something I didn't touch upon, is when I still do conventions, but people don't want to buy your covers or the art you've done for covers, because they just don't. But they'll buy, you know, a Buffy print or a Xena print or something. So I'll do like 2 for the show and just sell out, and that's it for the year. So this next one is something I just did for a show. Ooh, sorry. And everything starts out just the same. I will usually sketch on Photoshop. Just kind of keep working everything until I like it. I mean, it's really that simple. It's just kind of how it is here. These solid blacks are used the same exact brush. I just increased it a little bit. For the video, I hide the mouse cursor so you can actually see it. I want to see a big circle flip around. Unfortunately, I can't do that in Corel. Mention my name. That sounded arrogant, but if you mention my name, they'll cut you. They'll tell them what I'm gonna mention. The other thing is you have to be willing to, like I said, I don't like to work on weekends, but you have to be willing to sacrifice a little bit of your time to try and get the best possible product. Because if you don't make it the best you can, it's not exactly what the client wants, they won't come back. So this piece in particular, I want to say on and off for 3 weeks, I spent close to 40 hours on it. And, you know, a lot of people are like, why am I wasting so much time on it? Well, because at the end of the day, I think it looks good. Oh, right now what I've done is I've loaded everything into Corel. I have my black layer on top, I set it to multiply, and I'm just painting underneath with just it's called a varial airbrush. I just will lay in some very rough tones underneath, and then I zoom in and I start to work it. And now what I'm doing is I'm just starting to blend in my line work. I'm a big fan of line work, but you know, for clouds, it's kind of, it breaks the illusion.
So would you say you're
yeah, everything I would say is mostly digital. I still do traditional. I still, you know, I still love the feel of a pencil. Yeah, everything for business is all digital. It's just a time thing. Because if you do have a quick deadline, let's say I did an oil paint, right? I'd have to set up lights. I'd have to, you know, measure my light. I have to make sure the picture's perfect and I have to color correct it. Opposed to digital, when I'm done, compress it, set it. What I did there is just kind of like how a comic artist will drop a gradient. I drop gradients when I pick colors from that setup. It just keeps a harmonious flow to everything. Thing about, you know, learning as much as you possibly can about everything and not pigeonholing yourself, especially with these, is I started to get people to ask me, hey, can you make that for me? And I'm like, yeah, absolutely, I could make it as an advertising piece. And I started getting a lot of calls from people asking just for that. I want you to do the cover, I want you to record the whole thing, and I want you to turn it into a commercial right before we release it. Or maybe tell people about the other stuff, or lead them to our website, or maybe something I could use on my website. And all of a sudden, you know, I'm getting paid $1,000 for something that I did for fun just to show. And that's the problem. Art directors and, you know, independent authors, pretty much anyone you talk to outside of this room, they don't understand how art works. They visually don't understand it. So if you say, yeah, I could draw a face, or let's even make it simpler. You go to Marvel and like, hey, I could draw the Hulk. Do you have it in your portfolio? No, but I could do it. They don't care. Like, okay, good for you. You know, like they just don't care. You have to have the visual proof. And I actually started doing these and the comic convention stuff in a poster format because I really want to try and get into movie posters. And that is an uphill battle because they just don't want to deal with you. But, you know, thankfully I did get in. I'm doing one for Cowgirl now. It's an independent film. And I did one for Taking Flight. And it's just something where once you have something in your portfolio that you could point to, they'll come to you. You just have to get it in their hands. So you can't just, you know. Let me see. This says internet, right?
Establish your pricing, like, after graduation, and just, like...
Well, see, that's the other thing. When you leave... There it is. Once you leave school, you will get offers. I mean, it just happens. If you try, people are willing to hire you. And when most students get a job offer, the person offering the job usually will give you a price point. And I find that really didn't work out for me because you'll work on something and you'll end up getting underpaid. So I'm very blamed. And this is something not a lot of artists do. I tell people, here's what I charge. If you want to work for me, this is what I charge. If you don't want to work for me or you don't want to pay that fee, that's absolutely fine. Please go somewhere else when they could, you know, go to DeviantArt and find someone that could do your work. I'm not a negotiator. I've never been like, let's make a deal. I'm always black and white. If you want a cover and it's black and white and you need it in, say, a week, yeah, I'll do it for $450. If you don't, that's fine. And also, there's always stipulations, you know. You wouldn't charge an independent author the same you would charge to Penguin Publishing. Penguin Publishing, you'd work it, you'd get a better deal for yourself. You maybe get some rights to it. you know, opposed to someone like, hey, I just want to put something on Amazon. Okay, I'll work it. And that's actually where I get a lot of work, because I have packages. You know, like, you want me to do your full cover, interior, exterior, all that kind of stuff, there's my base price. Like, that's where I start. And, you know, I've talked to Rich about this so much. You will underprice yourself so badly. You'll end up working 30 hours, and we'll say you work 30 hours on something and you charge $300. What did you make on that? That's a waste of time. But if you work on something for 10 hours, you charge, you know, $300. Okay, now we're talking. You know, you just have to evaluate how fast you are and how much you can actually charge for it and get away with it. I was telling a story in the other room before this that I don't like doing logo work because logos are a headache. It's block plug-in. But logos are just a headache because most people don't know what they want. They're like, yeah, I want it to be fresh and edgy and hip. Like, those are buzzwords. Those mean nothing. Those don't tell me what you want on your thing. You know, if you're doing a dog treat company and you want it fresh, what does that mean? Do you want a dog bone? Do you want a collar? Do you want a dog? But yeah, fresh, hip. So I purposely do not do logos. But this one woman just would not leave me alone. She's just, let's hope I don't get it. This one woman just not leave me alone. She just really wanted a logo by me. And I said, yeah, okay, sure. Do it for $1,000. And she's like, okay. Let's do it. Yeah. Yeah, all of a sudden I'm on board because, you know, I just priced to basically not have to do it anymore. There. Black plug. Download Flash. Okay, we're not gonna be showing that one. But yeah, like, pricing is all, it's really all variable. You wouldn't charge someone who just wants something for fun opposed to someone who's been doing it for years. Because the people who've been doing it for years will try and manipulate you and pry on that inexperience to get the best possible price. And that's their job. So you just gotta prepare for it. I mean, I remember when I left here, I had, I'll keep things vague. I got a contract from a very, very big comic company. One of the top three, and it was awesome. It was probably the best break I ever got, and the author and I had signed a contract together to work out the rights, and I would get a cut on it on the back end, plus all the work I did. So I did the cover, I did all the interiors, which was about, you know, 25 pages, and it was in panel format, so they were big paintings. And it was great. I'm like, this is gonna come out, and it was a week before it was published. It was a week before it came out, and I was so excited. I'm sharing with everyone. I'm like, this is it, guys, I'm gonna make it. And I get a letter, and there are monikers in the top right. I'm like, oh, yes, this is my check. I open it to cease and desist order. I was like, oh, crap, what happened? Well, it turns out the author stole the script from someone else, they were scrapping the deal, and he was getting sued. So I'm like, well, damn. So like 6 months of work just went down the garbage. And I had no backup. You know, I still can't show that stuff. It's sitting in my closet. It's just, you just gotta prepare yourself for, okay, if I had set up a kill fee in the contract, if that went belly up, I'd still be getting paid. It's just things you don't even think about. It's like, okay, I have to protect myself even if this doesn't happen. Or I'll ask for a deposit up front. And I you know, I was 21, I didn't even think about it. But now, you know, you gotta realize it's part of the business, unfortunately.
Duncan's got another question.
Anybody else have a question? Mr. Forbes has a question
back. How did this work, by the way? The question I do have is that change from traditional to digital that you talked about. How difficult was it for you to know which software to get, what tablet to buy, all those little idiosyncrasies that you have to resolve yourself? Tell us a bit about that, please.
Sure. I'm not gonna lie, it was very difficult. Because when you're doing traditional, you're thinking about, oh, what's the best brush, what's the best hair? And then when you're going digital, which I didn't really know a ton about, I'm like, okay, what's the best brand of tablet? So all I did went to Amazon and I looked like, what's the highest rated one? Oh, this is $10,000 Cintiq. Like, I don't even know what I'm doing. So I actually just bought the cheapest thing I could. and I just started practicing on it and practicing. I got real good with it. And as for software, I tried, again, everything I could think of. I think the top two contenders are Photoshop. Like, everyone knows Photoshop. I never liked Photoshop because every time I use a brush, there's always this shine to it. And it, you know, when you're doing a comic or something like that, you could do it and it looks okay. But my style, it didn't really fit because all of a sudden, you know, I'm doing Xena and she looks like she just got polished. It didn't really look right. And I started to get frustrated, and then someone told me, hey, Corel allows you to use like traditional brushes. I'm like, okay, let's try it out. And I'm not gonna lie, like Corel is a great product for me. It works fabulous. It crashes like every 10 minutes. Like it is not the most sturdy of things, but what it does is it allows you to blend easier. So I could put a black and I could put a gray, and all of a sudden I do a stroke and it picks up all the colors from everything and it's blending and it's picking up like natural looking brush marks. I'm like, well, this is cool. And I would say I took a year to actually get to a spot where I'm like, I'm comfortable enough to start going to people like, here's my new stuff, what do you think? And a lot of clients were like, I like your old stuff, I don't want to use you. And unfortunately, I lost some people for that. But I also gained people who like digital. So it's always give and take. But you just have to, I guess you just got to really do your research. Amazon's a powerful tool. And now I have, you know, I have a Cintiq, I have three or four monitors, I got, you know, sketches on this one, I got my color palette on this one, working on the Cintiq. So it's really just kind of reteaching yourself the tools and fundamentals you've already learned here.
I was really curious to hear you talk about the authors that you work with. And can you talk a little about the relationship you have with some of the authors? And it seems like there's a collaboration going on there. And then also I'm intrigued about the working in Europe and how that happened.
Sure. But the author thing is pretty fantastic. If someone is, we'll say, accustomed to getting cover work done, they're amazing. They know exactly what they want, and you can build a relationship once they like it. But authors are a fickle beast. sometimes you'll say, hey, what does this chair look like? They'll send you, 15 paragraphs about a chair. I'm like, can you just find it on Amazon and send me a picture of the chair you're looking for? Because I'm a visual person. But the big thing I find is if I just kind of communicate with authors and try and keep it as professional as I can and quick. Because I know that sounds weird, but if I keep it quick and brief and contact them immediately, they're more willing to come back to me because they'll find that a lot of artists kind of don't respond, or they kind of just, they try and play I'll do it when I can. I'm just very professional. I'm like, okay, I'm booked right now. I could take you in a week. Okay. And then all of a sudden they realize, like, I'm on top of my schedule. I'm ready for this. And then how I keep it going is, I'm just a personable guy. I'll talk to them. And some of the best authors I've worked with have loved their covers, and they're actually submitting it for these awards. Like, I don't really put my stuff out there. I'm always a little apprehensive. But they're like, hey, I nominated you for this. And I'm like, oh, awesome. We won! and then it's even better for them because then they can put a sticker on there, like award winning for this and that. And I'm like, this is great. The Europe thing actually happened because I was working for a company called Grand Mall Press. And I did a cover for Ian Robright. And Ian's in the UK and Grand Mall Press is in California. And I did it. And basically Grand Mall Press and Ian had a breaking out. He wanted to do his own thing. They wanted to do their own thing. Ian contacted me and he's basically said, hey, you want to come work for me professionally?
Sure.
The price was right and he was offering me pretty much monthly work. So I'm like, yeah, okay. So he stayed over there and I stayed over here, and then he started up Salvia Publishing. And he asked me if I wanted to be the art director. And I was a little apprehensive because I'm like, don't I have to be on site for that? And he says, yeah, like maybe once or twice a month. I'm like, okay. And I did it, and I've gone over there a bunch of times. And it's awesome. You got great accents. But, but yeah, like that was really it. He just really liked my stuff, and he knew that I actually knew every facet of the business. I knew how to, finance a book. I knew how we do layouts. I knew interiors and exteriors because, you know, what I don't really show, because it's not flashy, is I also know how to format interiors of books. You know, that's just something people don't even think about. Like, oh yeah, you gotta actually format it for print. You know, you gotta basically learn graphic design. And he took me on, and from there people would start contacting me, and I had, you know, Salpan Publishing, kind of a web address and web domain, and I had students contact me. He's like, hey, I want to do a cover. And, you know, I'm always very nice. I always respond, sure, show me what you could do. Show me your art. Why do you, I always ask, why? Why do you want to do a cover? And their answers are priceless. You know, sometimes like, I just want to get in the business. I'm like, that's great. Why do you actually want to do it? You know, if you want to get in the business, that's awesome. Be prepared for a lot of people to say no.
Since you said you wanted to get into poster design, right?
Mm-hmm.
So would that mean like artists like Drew Strausen are a big influence on you for that?
Very much so, yeah. When I actually finish a painting, I do everything in oil painting, and I do everything like a traditional oil painting with the airbrush, and then I go in there with basically a colored pencil brush, and just do exactly what Drew does. Like I'll hit eyelines or I'll hit highlights and I'll push it, and yeah, I love Drew Strausen. I'd love to meet Drew Strausen. You can thank Rich for that. He told me a lot about Drew Strausen.
I have a question about the typography.
Sure.
There was a time when you looked at a book jacket and it was designed by, and then the illustrations by someone else. Are you in a unique position that you have control over this, or is this something that that still occurs?
I would say I'm in a very unique position. Not a lot of people could do both. I majored in both at one time. I've always tried to tell people, you know, I don't want to be a one, like, you know, a work for hire kind of come to me and then go somewhere else for the type. I was like, you know what? I could do the type. And they're like, oh, okay. So all of a sudden there's just one contract. I'm doing the type, I'm doing the painting, and then on top of that I could design everything as I go so things would flow into each other. So opposed to a graphic designer later on being like, okay, I want to play with the type and maybe move this character around, I could just work with the client and give them exactly what they want. And one of the best things I do is I actually have a questionnaire I give everyone for a cover. And this is something I've just kind of honed over the years. But let's say, you know, you come to me and, hey, I want a book cover. Okay, fill out this questionnaire. If you can't fill out that questionnaire, you're not ready. Because the questionnaire is pretty straightforward. What's the title? Who's the author? Are you under a different name, or is it just you? What's the subtitle? what don't you like? What do you like? What do you want on there? And this also allows me to evaluate if I'm the right artist for them. Because you also find that people tend to group artists into one category, kind of like, you know, a lawyer doesn't know everything about law. There's very specific artists. So I get comic artists, people asking me for tattoos or, you know, hey, I'm looking for a graphic design. Like, I really don't do like editorial layouts, but I could reference you to someone who does. Or I get a lot of people asking for like hentai and stuff like that. And I'm, you know, I'm like, that's cool, you know, whatever floats your boat, but that's not really what I do. I don't feel comfortable. I drew enough naked people at the academy. I don't need to draw naked people anymore. And that's fine, I'll send it to someone else who does. But at least I know from that I know what they're looking for. And it's unfortunately not me. And vice versa, I could know exactly what someone wants. So, and I'll also ask, like, you know, hey, give me three other covers that you really like, or maybe covers of mine that you really like, and I'll know exactly what you want. Because people may say, I want a really cool guy, and I want him to look tough, and, you know, maybe have knives coming out of his back. I'm like, okay, send me three other covers you like. Well, all the covers have red backgrounds. All the covers have the guy, or a character who's a silhouette. I'm like, okay, he didn't know, or she didn't know how to specify this, but they want this. And then I do it, and they're like, oh, you're like a mind reader. I'm like, I'm actually not. I'm just picking up on context clues that you didn't know to tell me. So, you know, it's just really about harnessing all the information you could possibly get and then giving them what they want. And, you know, it takes a while to learn that. It truthfully, it just takes a long time to learn that. Because they don't, you know, it's not like you go to illustration class and Rich is like, project today, you ask me what I want and you paint it. He gives you a sheet and this is exactly what you're supposed to do. So, it's a learning process. fade to black. Any other questions? Or we got time?
Let's thank Stephen.
Oh. Thank you.